With the letter to the Acts of the in Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 9 and 17 through 18. This is a classic story. Meanwhile, Saul, while breathing threats and murder against the disciples, when he went to the high priest, the priest asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus. So if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground, and he heard a voice say, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, the one whom you are persecuting. But get up, enter the city, and you will be told there what to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard a voice, but they saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and he ate and drank nothing. At the urging of the Lord, a disciple named Ananias went and entered the house where Saul was staying. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Herein we seek wisdom. And now, if you're able, would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age." May we hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
When Phil told me that I would be preaching from the Paul chapter of Marcus Borg's reading the Bible again for the first time, I must admit I was a little bummed. Paul, really? You know, of all the parts of the Bible to preach on, I had to get Paul? You know, Paul's got kind of a bad rap. He comes across as so judgmental, not to mention some of the pretty misogynistic things written in some of the letters attributed to him. And people love to use him to beat people up spiritually, which says to me that perhaps the writings of Paul are the parts of the Bible that we most need to read again for the first time, as Marcus Borg suggests. After all, if it weren't for Paul, it is quite possible that we would not be sitting in his sanctuary today. It was the work of Paul that helped spread Christianity throughout the ancient world. He brought it out of the Middle East to parts of Asia and to Europe. And if we're honest, some of the most troubling things about Paul's writings, those things that make us think he's so judgy, are things that have been twisted by Christians over the century, so much so that they have lost much of their original meaning. Because if you take a deep look at the letters of Paul, there are some really heavy, deep theological things that he is wrestling with, and they can't just be used as verses that we fling out to people as little cute sayings or ways of living our life. It's a deep theological look that he's taking. So let's delve into some aspects of the person and writings of Paul. As we heard in the reading from Acts this morning, Paul was a zealous man. His faith was very important to him. He came from the Pharisaic tradition, and we all know how well the Pharisees got along with Jesus. So Paul, then known as Saul, was breathing threats and murder against the disciples of Jesus. He was on the lookout for any followers of the way so he can bind them and bring them to Jerusalem. Damascus, something incredible happened. Something that changed Paul's life forever. A light from heaven flashed around him, knocked him down, and blinded him. There on the road, he met Jesus, who said, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" For 3 days, Paul lived in blindness and neither drank nor ate. One might say he descended into darkness for 3 days, and then, when a disciple of the Lord came to him and restored his sight, Paul was resurrected to a new life. This notion of dying to the old way of life and being resurrected into a new way of life is central to Paul's writings. I've been holding a baptism class with some of our older kids, and in our last meeting, we talked about what baptism symbolizes. It is the act which transitions us from the old life to the new life. As Paul writes in Romans 6, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, so we too might walk in the newness of life." Paul talks about this old way of life as life in Adam, which is separation and estrangement from God. It is the condition under which all humanity lives, under the dominion of sin. It is not merely a matter of choosing right or choosing wrong, because in Adam, we are captive to the law of sin and therefore not free. As Paul writes in Romans 7, "I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. The good that I would do, I do not do. But the evil that I would not do, that I do." Do these words resonate with anyone besides me? Because then, as Paul writes, in Christ, we are no longer enslaved to the dominion of sin and death. We are free. We dwell in the presence of God as Christ lives in the presence of God. We hear Paul talk of life according to the flesh and life according to the Spirit. And this often gets interpreted as flesh referring to our physical bodies, as though our bodies are bad or that there is something wrong with enjoying our bodies. But what Paul meant when he said life according to the flesh and life according to the Spirit is life in Adam and life in Christ. Yes, Paul's description of life according to the flesh does involve some actions that are bodily in nature: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, drunkenness, and carousing. We've all heard that list before. But it also includes traits that are not connected to indulging our bodies: idolatry, enmity, strife, jealousy, quarrels, dissensions, factions, and envy. On the other hand, life according to the Spirit, life in Christ, is characterized by love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And these characteristics can certainly guide what we do with our bodies. So Paul is not making a distinction here between our actual bodies and our spirits. Rather, he is offering ways of death and ways of life to guide how we live in our bodies. Another important aspect of the writings of Paul is the centrality of community. Paul's letters are written to different communities throughout the ancient world: Corinth, Rome, Thessalonica, Galatia, Philippi. And now we only have one side of the conversation. Paul's writings were in response to news he heard from these communities, to questions various members of the communities asked him, and he wrote those responses in his own letters. There was a very real and specific context for all that Paul wrote, which is important for us to keep in mind before we take his words and use them to berate and chastise. At the heart of living in the way of Christ was living in community. In Christ, we enter a new social reality. For in Christ, there is no longer Jew or Gentile. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all are one in Christ Jesus. The distinctions that matter so much for those who experience life in Adam, those fade away when one knows life in Christ. In his letter to the Corinthians, Paul took this even further to address distinctions between the rich and the poor. He had learned that the Christian community in Corinth was eating the Lord's Supper in what he considered before those who were poor could arrive from work. So Paul chastised them, writing, "When you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. When you come together, it is not really to eat the Lord's Supper. For when the time comes to eat, each of you goes ahead with your own supper, and one goes hungry and another becomes drunk. What? Do you not have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you have contempt for the church of God and humiliate those that have nothing?" As Borg points out, Paul then warns them of eating the Lord's Supper without discerning the body, meaning the community. As Borg writes, the issue is not the centuries later Christian concern with discerning the real presence of Jesus in the elements of the Eucharist, but rather the betrayal of the body, namely the egalitarian social reality of life in Christ. Another central tenet of the writings of Paul is the notion of justification by grace. This has been used and interpreted in a variety of ways over the centuries, but many of them miss what Paul originally intended. In Galatians, this notion emerged because there were Christian Jews who were insisting that the Gentiles who wanted to be part of the community be circumcised first. They had a good case for this, for the Torah clearly required circumcision, but Paul presented a different way of seeing by insisting that Gentiles were justified by their faith in Christ. As Borg writes, justification by grace is radical. Though the language has been domesticated by familiarity, it is extraordinary. God justifies the ungodly, Paul says. A few verses later, Christ died for the ungodly. Then, while we were yet sinners and enemies of God, Christ died for us. God's love for us is prior to our worthiness. It need not be earned. Indeed, it cannot be earned. One important thing to understand about justification by grace in opposition to justification by works of the law is that it does not point to the inadequacy of the Jewish law or Judaism. I cannot tell you the number of times that I have heard some Christians say something like, "Well, the God of the Old Testament is one of judgment, but the God of the New Testament is one of grace, faith, and love." First of all, the God of the Old Testament is the God of the New Testament. And there is judgment to be found in Christianity just as there is grace to be found in Judaism. As Borg points out, when Paul indicts life under the law, he is not attacking the Torah in particular. On the contrary, he saw the Torah as holy, just, and good. But the way of being Paul indicts, his attack on the law, subverts a more universal way of being, found not only within Christianity and Judaism, but also within secular culture. Life under the law is the life of measuring up, in which our well-being depends on how well we do. Life under the law, as one contemporary scholar puts it, is living according to the performance principle. That is not what justification by faith is about. It's about the basis of our relationship to God in the present. It is not about human accomplishment. It is a gift of God. It is about becoming conscious of and entering more deeply into an already existing relationship with God as known in Jesus. There is so much to Paul that we need to remember that I can't even begin to encapsulate in this short sermon on a Sunday morning. But perhaps one of the aspects that rises above the rest for me, I've touched on a little bit, but it's of the inclusiveness that Paul preached. One of the persisting arguments that took place in the early Christian community is described at length in the book of Acts. It's between Peter and Paul. They argue about whether or not this way was meant just for Jews or whether it was available to Gentiles. Peter really thought that it was meant for just the Jewish community. But Paul insisted that it was not meant to be constrained to just those who were Jews. It was meant for the non-Jewish as well, for the Gentile. The way is not for those who is not only for those who can check certain boxes pertaining to their background, their ethnicity, their heritage. It is meant for Jew and Gentile alike.
slave and baby alike, men and women alike. Because as can be seen throughout the Bible and in the world throughout history, living a life of love and compassion is not just reserved for those with right belief. Earlier this week, someone shared a story with me that was written by her favorite Southern author, Sean Dietrich. I want to close with this story as a reminder of the ability all of us have to participate in the work of Christ in this world. Dietrich sets the stage before he dives into the story, and I amended a couple words because of one of those. So if you find it, you'll nothing really bad. This is the quintessential beer joint. There are pool tables, chain smokers, dartboards, a jukebox, and a private stage. There's a young guitarist. He knows three songs. He repeats them. My friend tells the waitress that I'm a writer, if that's what you call it. My pal is only teasing me. The waitress says she has a good story. And without awaiting my response, she's already telling it. She is the quintessential barmaid, a no-nonsense woman, mid-50s, a few tattoos on her forearm, tough. Okay, she begins, like she's rehearsed. So there was this homeless guy. I like the story already. She tells me the man rode his bike all over town. She often saw him on her way to work and wondered where he was going. So one day she followed him. He lived behind a strip mall in the woods. She discovered he had a son. It was enough to break her heart, she adds. They were living underneath a truck. The next day, she and a friend delivered gift bags, a prepaid cell phone, snacks, clothes, toys, food, as many items as they could fit into a few gym bags. He was skittish, she said. Very protective of his son, didn't want us getting close. She couldn't get him off her mind. She contacted her brother-in-law, a church deacon. She convinced his church to offer him room and meals. One night, she approached the homeless man with the offer. She walked right up to his camp. This woman is fearless. He refused. He told her he didn't want her charity. So I got in his face, she said. Told him if he didn't take my hand out, I was going to call the law and have his kid removed. Magic. He moved into a small Sunday school room where she had and her friends had outfitted with beds and a mini fridge. The church agreed to hire him as a custodian, and they paid him. People brought casseroles upon casseroles. The boy attended school. He was smart. And I understand he was a good athlete. She went to his games. She says it didn't take long for the man to save enough to buy a car and get his own apartment. Eventually, he got on his feet, and she's never heard from him again. That was a decade ago. The end, she says. I asked if she'd let me write about it. She nods and tells me she doesn't want recognition. That's not why she told me the story. She is very clear about this. She goes on. All I want average folks to know, we can make a difference in this world if we just try, you know? I mean, come on, y'all. Yeah. Shoot, I can do it, she says. I mean, just look at me. I ain't no big Christian or nothing. Man, you are the biggest kind there is. May we, like Paul, practice a Christianity that is free of labels. May we learn from his example to open the doors to any who wish to walk in the way. May we join together in community with all who endeavor to live in love and compassion. May we recognize that we are truly one body of Christ, working alongside each other in the spirit of Christ to do the work of the kingdom. Thanks be to God. Let us join our hearts, minds, and voices together. Thank you.